Buenas tardes. Good afternoon. This is Co-op Radio, KFRO 102.7 FM, www.coopradio.org. On the internet, today we have a program, a real-life program that rivals editions of that best-selling book, The Da Vinci Code. Our two guests are Professor James Dierdorf, a professor emeritus at a university in Oregon, who has a PhD in atmospheric sciences and is one of the leading scholarly authorities on a document that he'll speak more to called the Talmud of Emmanuel. Our second guest at 12:30 is Michael Horn, who's the authorized representative of an alleged extraterrestrial contactee, a Swiss man named Meyer. Now, you might ask, do extraterrestrial contactees have to do with public affairs at Co-op Radio? Well, one of the issues that Mr. Horn will be speaking about is a series of predictions and prophecies given out by the extraterrestrials, allegedly, to Mr. Meyer for the next quarter century of our history here on the planet. Apparently, they have advanced time travel capability, and it doesn't look very good. We're going to cover three main topics in this important program, which is part of a continuation of Co-op Radio's Life in the Universe series, that is, life other than here on this planet, beyond the geostationary orbit. The first question we'll be covering with Professor Dierdorf is, was the historical Jesus an extraterrestrial contactee? A recent book suggests that, for example, the Fatima miracle was a UFO-related phenomenon, kind of a disinformation of Virgin Mary. Secondly, should we pay attention to a pattern of confirmed predictions of a possible human nightmare scenario that's just down the road for us? War, pestilence, famine, seven horses of the apocalypse, you know, nine-tenths of the Earth's population eradicated. And third, and this is an important public policy issue, once you get beyond and into the top secret files that extraterrestrial civilizations are visiting Earth, some of whom have made deals with the United States government, for example, allegedly. What is the role of ethical extraterrestrial intervention in creating, number one, human religions, as we're about to find out, and number two, promoting world peace? Conversely, what is the role of unethical extraterrestrial intervention in destabilizing human society? We'll be starting with Professor James Dierdorf. James, are you on the line? Hello?
Yeah, he's on the line.
Oh, good. James, I wondered if you could very briefly tell our listeners what the Talmud of Emmanuel is and why you believe it has authenticity as a possible or probable source of the New Testament.
Well, although it's a long story, I'll try to get a little brief summary in here. It was discovered back in 1963 in Jerusalem by a UFO contactee by the name of Billy Meyer from Switzerland, who at that time was traveling around the world and was with his friend, an ex-priest named Esau Rashid. And since this time, many of Billy Meyer's experiences have been so well verified, and as many photographs of UFOs and everything have been found to be just unable to be hoaxed in any way, and he has so much supportive witnesses from people who know him well, that one doesn't really, one must think twice, I would say, day before trying to call him a hoaxer of any sort. Anyhow, he's the one who is still surviving to vouch for the genuineness of his find of this document that he was prompted through extraterrestrial mental telepathy where to go as they were walking in the south side of Jerusalem one day back in 1963, and he saw this little crevice in the hillside. His attention was directed there, and he went up and scooped it out a little bit to find that it went into a bigger crevice in the hill, and later at night he and his friend came and enlarged it and crawled in and found out that it was an old abandoned, half-buried tomb site. And under a rock in this tomb site, after they excavated quite a lot of stuff out, dirt out, they found this document encased in leather, and the leather had been then all encased in rosin. And it was Aramaic writing on the document. And Meyer's friend Rashid had a Palestinian background and was able to start translating the old Aramaic. And they soon found out how heretical it was for Judaism and for Christianity both. So from then on, it was a very secret translation project that Rashid did on this document to try to get it translated so that it would become known to the world. Rashid was allowed to have the custody of the document. Meanwhile, Meyer went on traveling around the world, working his way around, eventually going back to Switzerland. And after along about 1970 or so, he received in the mail the first batch of translations of this document. And so that's the Talmud of Emmanuel. We pronounce it Emmanuel, although it's spelled with a capital J symbol at the front. That's the way they found it written in the Aramaic scrolls that they found.
Hello?
Yes, go ahead, please.
Just to clear up one quick question, I happened, by the way, I was, it's very hard to get a hold of this book, and in the last week of October, I was wandering in a used bookstore on Granville and Davie here in Vancouver, seeking out another book, and I went down to the used bookstore section, and right there was a almost pristine copy of the Talmud of Emmanuel, which apparently had been just come into the store. So I was able to get a copy of it, and at the end of it, there's a letter dated, I think it's September 1974, from Rashid to Billy Meyer, September 14th, and then Billy Meyer responds a week later. And what Rashid says is that essentially he was in a Palestinian refugee camp with the translation project. He had been shadowed by Israeli military intelligence agents who had discovered what his project was, and that the camp was attacked with the purpose of destroying the scrolls, which apparently they did. So there's no extant documentation. I wanted to comment on that, but also comment on how one makes, or you as a scholar make the argument that yes, the original, even though the original scrolls do not exist, the following is the argument that this is a genuine document.
That's a letter, you summarized it pretty well. So if you try to alert New Testament scholars about it, they will just assume, well, it has to be some sort of a hoax. We're not going to waste our time on any document discovered nowadays or even the last century if we don't have the originals to radiocarbon date and so on. And so that's why most people may not have heard of it. So I, having had a background in the atmospheric sciences, got aware of the Meyer UFO contacts, ET contacts, back around 1980, and became interested in them, and learned about the Talmud of Emmanuel in 1984, and started looking into it, having had a background, was raised in doubt. And after realizing then, well, yeah, that seems to be true, reincarnation could well be a truth, I continued to study the Talmud of Emmanuel even further, and found it rather obvious, actually, that either the Gospel of Matthew was formed out of this early, an early transcription of this Talmud of Emmanuel, or else, of course, the Talmud of Emmanuel with these recent 20th century hoax. It has to be one or the other because the parallels are sufficiently close between the verses and passages in the two different documents. So by comparing these passages, one by the other, over and over, one can try to make an unbiased judgment. As could this verse have come from the Talmud of Emmanuel? Why would the writer of Matthew have changed this and that, make it come out to us another way? Or why would a hoaxer try to use the Gospel of Matthew to alter this verse and so on? And over again, it looks like it's much easier to say that the writer of Matthew altered the Talmud of Emmanuel than to look at it in the reverse. So this is called usually redaction criticism within New Testament scholasticism. One has to use that type of reasoning. We call it looking at the internal evidence to try to find out, for example, was the Gospel of Mark based upon the Gospel of Matthew, or was the Gospel of Matthew based upon the Gospel of Mark, because the two of those are very similar. So that's the main basis I go on by judging the Talmud of Emmanuel genuineness, other than knowing that Meyer is strictly honest and credible, and not one who would deceive anyone, and also looking at the indications that the Talmud Emmanuel was an ancient document. For example, it contains some Aramaisms. When it was translated into German, the translation wasn't made perfectly literally in perfect understandable German. Here and there, they made a little bit more of a literal translation, which it did, and it comes out a little bit awkward, and you can tell from that backwards that, yes, it must have been an Aramaic expression that was translated into the German, and it wasn't then rearranged into very convenient modern German yet. And the punctuation indicates that it looks like it has been an old document. They don't find a lot of words strung together with "and," which indicates there hadn't been any commas in it. Of course, manuscripts back then didn't have commas. But mostly it comes from these 350 verses comparing each one with the Gospel of Matthew that's in the Talmud of Emmanuel. And these are parallel verses, that is, verses that are so similar, you can tell one, in most cases you can tell that one came directly from the other. And that's the main reason that it looks like the Talmud of Emmanuel is genuine. We call it the internal evidence. And so there's also what we call the external evidence. And one example of that is where the early church fathers in the second, third centuries and on claimed that, well, yes, the Gospel of Matthew came first, and then came Mark, and then came Luke, and then came John. And modern 20th century scholars from then on decided that, well, it would be much nicer if Mark came first. It's shorter, and that would explain why Mark doesn't contain the important things in Matthew, like the Sermon on the Mount and many of the parables and quite a few of the teachings. So if we say Mark comes first, that would explain that and avoid a terrible theological embarrassment. Well, the Talmud of Emmanuel indicates, well, the embarrassments are there, and one can work backwards easily and see why the fathers went awry there in the 20th century. They were just a little bit too theologically committed.
Are passages in the Talmud of Emmanuel that are not in the Book of Matthew and that really triggered this program because they're extraordinary. I'm looking at chapter 3 of the Talmud of Emmanuel, which is entitled John the Baptist, and describes John the Baptist baptizing Emmanuel or Jesus. And let me read it, Jim, here on the air. So John consented and baptized him. This is from the Talmud of Emmanuel. Verse 30, when Emmanuel had been baptized, he soon came out of the water of the Jordan, and behold, a metallic light dropped from the sky and descended steeply over the Jordan. Verse 31, consequently, they all fell on their faces and pressed them into the sand while a voice from the metallic light spoke. Verse 32, this is my beloved son with whom I am well pleased. He will be the king of truth who will lift this human race to knowledge. Verse 33, behold, after these words, Emmanuel entered into the metallic light, which climbed into the sky, surrounded by fire and smoke, and passed over the lifeless sea, as the singing of the metallic light soon faded away. Verse 34, after that, Emmanuel was no longer seen for 40 days and nights. In other words, the whole scenario in the Talmud of Emmanuel is that when John the Baptist baptizes Jesus, the UFO comes down, Jesus so willingly, and what the book of Matthew says is the 40 days and nights in the desert was actually inside a UFO. And then you go to chapter 4 of the Talmud of Emmanuel, entitled Emmanuel's Secret, and it says, from this day on, Emmanuel no longer lived among humankind, among the races. Emmanuel was lifted up from the earth, and no one knew where he had been taken or what happened to him. But then he was led off by the metallic light between north and west, where the guardian angels had received cords with which they had to measure the place for the chosen ones. And it goes on to describe kind of a briefing inside a UFO or some other planet or some domain that Jesus received for what Matthew says was the 40 days and nights in the desert. That's an extraordinary departure. That says that Jesus was a UFO contactee. And I wonder how you, as both a biblical scholar, an atmospheric scientist, and a UFO and extraterrestrial researcher, measure all of that inside your sort of scientific judgment.
Well, I found it very interesting. Also, that description you described of that the manual made or dictated to his disciple writer to write down in the Talmud of Emmanuel of his 40 days and nights there is pretty reminiscent of what the ancient man Enoch experienced, that he wrote down, or descendants wrote down in the book we call One Enoch. Tegoni described things as they best they could, and they wouldn't know. Of course, even we don't today know about what it would be like to be in a UFO, except we know they can over where they are, and they can have motherships that are quite large. They fly on. I know anything that's going on anywhere on the earth, that sort of thing. So I just found it interesting reading, and there's a lot of places, of course, in the Talmud Manual that stuff like this didn't make it into the Gospel of Matthew. They wouldn't have known just what to do with it, and it just fits the early Christian thought of Jesus being a figure of worship, Son of God, or actually God himself, and would detract from the worship of Jesus that was the basis of early Christology, of early Christianity. So anyhow, I think it's a very interesting reading. I certainly lot of realism in it. There's many other sections that work but in the Gospel Manual also. Yes, this all flows along the Talmud of Manual itself with the Gospel of Matthew having picked up on it here and there where it could put in things that weren't heretical to early Christianity and made alterations where they could. But Gospel of Matthew had to just say this was the work of the devil to be taken away for 40 days and nights. And indeed, that's the way many fundamentalists today would view the UFO phenomenon, that UFOs are instruments of the devil, that sort of thinking. So some things haven't changed very much.
phenomenon. Some external intelligence created some virtual reality that morphed into the Virgin Mary apparitions. And so this would be on a parallel, the Virgin Mary being the, quote, historical mother of Jesus, Emmanuel in the book of, in the Talmud of Emmanuel. It would suggest, now that we have two data points, the Talmud of Emmanuel, the Enoch story, as you pointed out, but now an actual data-based analysis based on the historical records of Fatima. This is, you know, these weren't Israeli military intelligence did not come in and bomb these out. So now we have three data points that we can look at in terms of the possible role of extraterrestrial civilizations intervening in creating or manipulating human religion. I wonder if you could comment. We only have 5 minutes left in this segment, and I realize it's a tall order, but if you could comment on that, Jim.
Now, I haven't read that book, but I've long since formed the opinion myself that the Fatima experience event was a UFO event, simply because there were so many hundreds or thousands of people there that experienced it, and they saw something that looked as bright as the sun, but it wasn't, obviously wasn't the sun because it moved around and things like that. And we know of many instances where there are UFO, where appearances of the Virgin Mary were some sort of a manifestation created by UFOs. It's not just this one. But actually, most ufologists feel there's many other UFO events from 1947 on that have a lot more witness credibility even than the Fatima sightings. So there really, you could say there are hundreds of cases out there that if scientists could be made to really look into them open-mindedly, they would see how real the UFO thing is. Now, in the Talmud Emmanuel itself, there is plenty of other instances, or quite a few, that indicate that Emmanuel had been, alias Jesus, had been a UFO contactee, and some of these in altered form have slipped into the Gospel of Matthew, like, for example, the Star of Bethlehem. We know that there's no way that a star can hover over a particular place, in a particular city, in a particular country area, to guide any visitors or magi to a particular birthplace of a person. That just never has made sense, even though astronomers over the decades have tried to say, oh, it must have been Jupiter or a supernova or whatever. And the Talmud Emmanuel is clear what it is. It was the bright light in the sky with a long tail. We do have other indications from plenty of UFO experiences where UFOs have had a beam of light, looks like sometimes a smaller light that comes down. It can indicate a particular position if it wants. And in the Gospel of Matthew, one thing did come through in the day of the empty tomb being discovered, when the two Marys were there at the tomb, and the angel came and spoke to the Marys, and this there is described in a little more detail in the Talmud of Emmanuel, where you could see it was a UFO alien, and he pointed something in his finger at one of each of these guards that were guarding the tomb, and then they each one became paralyzed for quite a long time. So this explains the reason that Gospel Matthew said that they became like dead men. Later got up and tried to tell their superiors or the priests what had happened to them. So there, here and there in the Talmud Emmanuel, we get to see that the UFO influence, extraterrestrial intervention was going on, but in a fairly subdued form. There was no attempt even then, 2,000 years ago, to take over any of society or anything like that. This is just a special case of Emmanuel being given special attention.
they ascribe to, quote, God, in fact, may be created by or largely influenced by advanced extraterrestrial civilizations. Now, we have only 30 seconds to answer that question.
Well, this is one reason the Talmud Emanuel was so heretical after the Israeli authorities learned about it back in 1974. So they had to try to destroy it at all costs, because in the Talmud Emanuel, Emanuel explains that what they thought of as God was really a human-like person who was much, much, much more evolved than we are in his, especially in his spiritual evolution. And he was a leader of the other extraterrestrials that it's called the guardian angels, or just angels, in the Gospel of Matthew. And this gives plenty a reason why the Talmud Emanuel did have to get destroyed. It just couldn't have an original document with the Aramaic writing that explained all this. They just couldn't let it survive. No way. And Christianity wouldn't be able to either, since the Talmud Emanuel shows how Emanuel survived the crucifixion and went on and traveled around in Anatolia and eventually went on towards India. And we do have all this evidence that he had lived in the Kashmir area for many, many years. So it's very heretical, and major religions just have to ignore it, and if it ever comes to their attention, they're going to have to ridicule it. And they can get away with that now, since only the translation exists, and two separate scholars aren't interested in looking into it. Just has to be an independent scholar here and there, like myself, who will look into it.
Jim, we want to thank you very, very much. We've run out of time in this segment, in this fascinating area. We want to thank you for your participation, and hope that we can have further programs with you. This is Vancouver Co-op Radio. We've been with Professor James Dierdorf, Professor Emeritus at Oregon State University, a professor of atmospheric sciences. This is Vancouver Co-op Radio, CFRO 102.7, FM, www.cooperadio.org. This is the Monday Brownbagger. I'm Alfred Weber. We're in a Co-op Radio Life in the Universe program, in our Life in the Universe series. And we'll be back momentarily after a break with our second guest, Michael Horn.
Radio, 102.7 FM, CFRO in Vancouver, and your host, Alfred Weber, and the Monday Brownbagger.
Thank you very much. Welcome to www.cooperadio.org. Live on the internet. Just a reminder that this is listener-sponsored radio, and we have our annual general meeting for all co-op radio members coming up on Sunday, November 27th at 1 p.m. at the Firehouse. Y'all in Vancouver know where that is. And we urge that all members come to that meeting for an important, important meeting. We have 7 seats on the board of directors vacant and a lot of very important issues for the future of listener-sponsored radio. Co-op Radio in Vancouver that brings you programs like this. We are now transiting in this Life in the Universe program to be with Michael Horn, who is the official media representative of the Swiss gentleman who Professor James Dierdorf was speaking about, Edward Meyer, known as Billy Meyer. And in this segment, we will be covering the following question. Should we pay public attention to a pattern of confirmed predictions of a possible human, quote, nightmare scenario in our generation? A nightmare scenario is an alternative future we can choose to avoid if we are collectively aware of this nightmare possible future. So now we're going to make you aware of what Israeli military intelligence, Swiss military intelligence, and a lot of military intelligence agencies have been profoundly aware of for the last 30 years. Welcome, Michael.
Alfred, can you hear me okay?
I should say, Michael and I just finished touring Eastern Australia for about 3 weeks in September and early October. Michael is a Qigong master who teaches Qigong to the elderly in old age homes. And I don't consider myself elderly, but he's taught me some Qigong moves that are pretty neat. Michael, I'd like to ask you this. I think in the 20 minutes that we have remaining, what might be good is for about 5 minutes to establish the credibility of these predictions that were told to Billy Meyer by various extraterrestrial actors. And in the last 15 minutes, go into what some of the nightmares might be. I'd just like to quote, as we start, from what one of the extraterrestrials allegedly said. This is from an article in Nexus Magazine on this. You can find that article along with the program description at www.exopolitics.com and also at Michael's website www.theyfly.com. It says, provided that human beings of Earth will become reasonable, the possibility exists that by a reasonable change in the way of thinking, as well as a reasonable development in feeling and an equally reasonable way of acting, everything changes for the better and positive.
Right.
But prophecies do not have to be fulfilled. However, if this transition does not occur, a very evil, wicked, and negative time lies ahead for the Earth and its entire population in the coming millennium. Well, I was just looking at the public opinion polls. This was a new poll that just came out, YEW Foundation, very excellent public opinion poll, and they said that depending on how you ask the question, between 76 and 82% of even the U.S. population doesn't want weapons in space. So let's say that, 80% of the world's population wants peace, and it's just the other 20%. I mean, 80% of us are there, so over to you, Michael.
Sure. Alfred, can you hear me okay on this connection?
Yes, he can, sir.
Well, good. First, thank you kindly. I'm not a Qigong master. I just teach the stuff myself, but I understand the spirit in which you said that. Let me say this. The Meyer case, which actually has been ongoing, and we'll say allegedly only once at the top of this, people can determine this for themselves by investigating, and they can do that for free at have been ongoing now for more than 63 years, with voluntary face-to-face contact with a young boy to now a middle-aged man, Albert Billy Meyer. He has produced six categories of still irreproducible physical evidence. There's 120 witnesses in the case. 15 have taken and passed lie detector tests. We've got a retired UN diplomat in there among them. We have a scientific examination of the physical evidence that corroborates its authenticity and irreproducibility. All that being said, in the information that you've just referred to, Alfred, in this case, Meyer has been publishing what we would call prophetically accurate information for 54 years. And if we just go back less than 50 years, maybe 47 years to August of 1958, Meyer published a letter, sent it to 25 European governments, and in it, among many, many things, several dozen, most of which have already come true, he foretold the two U.S. Gulf Wars with Iraq. And he also said that the second one leads to, and this is the quote, an unbelievable disaster. For the world that has now already recognized that the military direction of our country and other countries is going the wrong way, we can hearken back now to this being foreseen long ago. The attack on Iraq was also again warned of in 1995 by Meyer. It's in a published book that came out in 2001 before the attack. So if we're talking about the prophetic accuracy of Billy Meyer, we have literally volumes to go by and things that have been in publication prior to their occurrence. Now, the idea of weaponization of space, this is obviously a controversial thing and something that's not desired to some degree, and I hate to throw cold water in anything. Human beings are going to do anything that they are able to do and then make their mistakes and suffer from them and make course corrections. I would hope that we don't make this one, but I think it may already be somewhat in place. And I'll stop there.
Take predictions. One is a prediction of horrifying weapons and a possible world war. This is the extraterrestrial talking to Meyer, I assume. Due to the fault of scientists, enormous power will be seized upon by the power hungry and their military, and through laser weapons of many types, atomic, chemical, and biological weapons, also genetic technology, enormous misuse will occur, exploited for the purposes of war. The entire planet will become an arena of unparalleled suffering, which will never have existed before on Earth up to that time. The cruel happenings will last about 888 days and cause civilization to collapse. And it just goes on this way. Why should we believe this type of apocalyptic vision?
Any of it, frankly, we should look at it, and first we want to look at what is the level of credibility of the source. As a for instance here, something that's pretty much in front of us these days, and I think you know as well what I'm talking about, we have a situation going on in France where there has been tremendous unrest. It is arguably not over, and it's very unpleasant. We've had arson and all sorts of things. Now, just so that people will know a little more about the source here, in November of 1981, November 23rd, 1981, 24 years ago almost to the day, the following was published by Meyer. I first had it in my possession in 1986. It was in a book published in 1982. Here's the statement. Italy and France will be shaken due to revolutionaries who murderously and by arson destroy every order. Paris will be destroyed from within and burnt down. The inhabitants themselves are those who lay Paris into rubble and ashes via murder, arson, and revolution, while Italy also falls due to massacres. Now, before I read the next statement, let's say here that fortunately Paris has not been burnt down, and I hope we don't have to say not yet, but we've clearly seen arson and revolution and destruction, and Italy has not yet had massacres, and we hope that the yet isn't part of it. But let's go forward just 6 years. when Meyer, on February 28, 1987, publishes the following: France will not only be invaded by the aggressors from the outside, but will also be conquered from within as a result of collaborative forces and other forces. This can be envisioned as being the many foreigners of a different religion living in France at that time, and specifically Islam, which will be this force working from within. Now, two things. Here we have a prediction that France will be invaded from the outside, something which hasn't happened, and we don't want to say yet. But we have more specifics about the unrest inside of France, and it's specifically spelled out as being those people, collaborators inside, who are of Islamic bent, let's say fundamentalists or fanatics or whatever you want to call it. So in 1981 and 87, Meyer publishes this information along with tons of other stuff pertaining to many other countries, many other events. But this is in the news right now in front of our face. So your question was, why should we, quote-unquote, believe that horrible scenario for the future? My first answer was we shouldn't believe it. But we should look at the credibility of the source. If you do what I've done, and you do look at the content here, and I've already logged tons of it out that you can investigate for yourselves, you may find, as I did, that this falls in the category of, so far, virtually impeccable. My particular mission with these prophecies isn't to cheer and applaud how wonderfully accurate they are, but to help to make the rest of them wrong by bringing this into the forefront of public awareness so people can see literally where we are on this so-called prophetic roadmap.
Let me read from another segment of this, they call, I think it's contact number 215, epidemics, conflicts, and disasters. This is the extraterrestrial speaking. Not only AIDS will occur worldwide in the 1990s, but also epidemics as a so-called mad cow disease, BSE, out of which different strains of Creutzfeldt-Jakob syndrome will develop, lasting well into the new millennia. Also an epidemic known as Ebola will cause many deaths. This was, what was the date of the 215? Wasn't it 1987?
That was the one I was just referring to in 1987. That contact, known as also as the Enoch or Henoch prophecies, is full of quite a bunch of specific and rather unpleasant information, because prophecies are only probable outcomes based on the laws of cause and effect, and they are meant to show us what will happen based on actions already in motion if we do not make course corrections and rectify the direction that we're going in.
Okay, now, I would like to put the spotlight of these prophecies on our neighbors to the south. You're down there in the south, in Los Angeles, some say ground zero. There's another segment here. It says civil wars and anarchy in America. And here we go. Yet, quote, this is quoting the extraterrestrial, yet the misery on earth will continue as two terrible civil wars break out in America, whereby one will follow the other. Afterwards, the United States of America will break apart, and deadly hostility will prevail among her, which then leads to the division into five different territories, and it cannot be prevented that sectarian fanatics play a dictatorial role. And then it goes on with a lot of detail. Could you, as an American in the United States, comment on this? It's extraordinary.
But yeah, let me say this. When I first read this, and remember, this is information from some time ago, the prophecy there about the breakup of the United States and the Civil Wars is actually also in that document from 1981, and I read it in 86, and it made no sense to me whatsoever. However, nowadays, we look at what's happening with the various polarizations that are taking place, especially in the United States. You have various religious fundamentalist groups that are, you know, coming more and more into prominence, especially politically, trying to exert influence, and in the educational system. conflict developing vis-a-vis illegal immigration in the country as a whole, and specifically here in the Southwest. And that subject matter of illegal immigration is actually addressed in the Playard material from many years ago, when they spoke about some of the principles of a world of human beings, how they prosper or how they find themselves in trouble. And the illegal immigration issue is a very potent one, no matter where it occurs, because, as they pointed out, whenever people migrate strictly for economic benefit, not having solved those problems in their own country, there is a resulting degradation into the host country that affects its economic and social structure, and there is no growth for the country from which those people have migrated in terms of fighting to improve their structure, their politics, their governments, etc. All of this can be seen when we look at the polarization religiously, the illegal immigration, the fact that the corporations are exporting jobs as fast as they can. This is crossing all of the political and even religious spectrums, so the information in the Meyer case comes down to being that which is equal opportunity offenders. They've got something to bug everybody.
Well, but also, as I understand it, was there not a cause and effect relationship between the invasion of Iraq and the U.S. kind of neocon world domination agenda?
Well, sure. We can say that there is certainly, information that shows that the agenda of invading the Middle East, Iraq specifically, other countries, has been in the works for some time via the so-called neocons and all of that. And we violated some pretty profound, you might call them spiritual universal laws, when we attacked Iraq, maybe even when we attacked Afghanistan, as opposed to doing it in another way. Let me see if I can get that all in. When we attacked Iraq, we had not been attacked by Iraq, plain and simple. It was an act of aggression, no matter how we want to paint it or cloak it in justification. And more of the American people are finally seeing that, as are some of the lazy politicians who really didn't do their homework and just now are trying to distance themselves from all of this. So we violated what you might call the law of aggression, one of the laws of cause and effect, meaning it all boils down to the same thing. It's kind of an old, if you will, even biblical, do unto others as you would have them do unto you, because it's going to get done unto you sooner or later. Once you send out the pendulum, with good or with ill, it gets returned to you in kind, in its own time, in its own way. It's nothing personal. It's neither anti-American, nor anti-Israeli, nor anti-Canadian, or British, or anything else, to state the truth. If you act in a certain way, sooner or later, you will reap the fruits of those actions. And clearly, we have also been the most effective recruiting force for Al-Qaeda, which wasn't formally in a stronghold position in Iraq. So as to what you've said about cause and effect and these impacts here in the States, we are destroying our own country through creating the divisiveness as well around these illegitimate acts.
So that the prophecies of the possible civil wars and the breakup of the United States of America into five different territories may be, in some sense, if this goes forward and if the United States continues its aggression, partially be the result of this aggression.
Well, it certainly is contributing to it. It's not making peace. And it's certainly fair to say that as long as we live in the kind of ignorance that ignores the laws of cause and effect, we will, meaning human beings, always say, how can this happen to us, and why do they hate us, and all the rest, and we won't look at the legacy. There's one other unfortunate fact, and maybe this is true in some degrees for other countries, but I think uniquely to my country, in the past 60 years, we have launched over 200 acts of unprovoked aggression against other peoples, meaning people that had not attacked us, was not self-defense. Self-defense is not only a right, it's a responsibility. Aggression is a violation of responsibility and cause and effect. So with 200 unprovoked attacks against peoples all over the world, is it any wonder that we're seeing various manifestations of blowback and hostility, stress and dissolution at home? We have to correct these things.
again. And this will be our last question because we're just wrapping up this segment, Michael. Just in the past few weeks, the legislature of the state of Vermont entertained a bill or a motion which then passed, and that motion was to secede from the United States of America, essentially because the United States of America had become a worldwide aggressor and did not reflect the values of the people and the legislature of the state of Vermont. Do you think that this at all relates to America breaking apart?
Well, it certainly could be expressed that way literally, in the sense that a group of Americans have chosen to break apart from the policies of the country as a whole and are expressing it through that act of secession or whatever. But whether or not that will be part and parcel or pivotal to eventual, you know, breaking up of the country, should it even happen, just a prophecy, I really don't know. It's just, I think we're seeing things appear before our very eyes. It would give us reason to look at this information, and I hope people will visit the free info on my website at theyfly.com and dig into this.
Michael, we've come to the end of this segment. I know that there's a great deal. We're talking about developments which may unfold over the next quarter century, 25 years, and we hope that we can call on you from time to time to come back on the program with an update. But we want to thank you for your participation today. You've been with Michael Horn, the official media representative for a Swiss gentleman, Edward Billy Meyer. This is Vancouver Co-op Radio. You've been listening to the Monday Brown Bagger, another in our periodic Life in the Universe series of programs. CFRO 102.7 FM, www.cooperadio.org. Live on the internet. May you have a miracle-filled day. Thank you. I'm